Hello?
Hey, Jack. Hey, how's it going?
It's good. How are you?
Great, man. Thanks for doing this.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me.
Yeah. your audio sounds great.
Awesome.
Thanks for using
good to
the
hear.
Mic.
Yeah. Yeah, no problem.
Sometimes it'll be like air conditioner and all this other stuff.
Yeah, I tried to clean it up as much as I could.
Oh, no, it sounds awesome.
Sweet. Yeah, absolutely.
But thanks for doing this too.
Yeah, happy to be here. I'm glad to be on.
Cool. Yeah. So our podcast is about your journey in the music industry and how you got to where you are today.
Sweet. All right.
Yeah. And from my internet stalking, I found out that I think you live or you were born and raised in Southern California.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Raised in Southern California. Okay. I grew up in, I did my teenagers, the more important years, my formative years were in Huntington Beach, California.
Okay.
But as a kid, I lived out in Lake Elsinore. Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
So you were born, you grew up in Lake Elsinore? Or you,
yeah, grew up out there and then moved here when I was 10. So
right on. Yeah, we're in San Diego. So
oh yeah, sweet.
Close to you.
Oh yeah, I love San Diego. That's great.
I know the area. Right on, man. So grew up in Huntington Beach.
Yeah.
How did you get into music?
I got into music as a band kid, you know. So I played the trombone. I had played guitar at home, you know, played the blues, metal, all that kind of stuff, you know, closet metalhead, that kind of stuff. And then in middle school, I joined the middle school band and I played the trumpet. I was terrible. switched over to the trombone. And then in high school, I had a friend who played drums and he said, "Do you want to start a band?" Oh, sure. Why not? You know, I'll be in a band. Why not? It's better than, you know, orchestra. Why not?
Right.
Give it a shot. So played in some punk bands and ska bands in high school. And now I'm here, you know, I play with three bands, tour a little bit. It's great. Yeah.
That is awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty cool.
So in the high school band, did you play trombone? Were you like?
Yeah, I played
band?
Trombone and guitar, actually. In the high school jazz band, I was the lead guitarist and the principal trombonist.
Oh, my gosh.
So I'd switch back and forth.
Were there songs that had, I mean, I would assume there are songs with both elements, you know?
Yeah, so the other trombone player would play the first part if I had a guitar part, and we'd switch back and forth.
Oh,
it worked out pretty
it.
Good. Yeah, yeah.
That's cool. That's
yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So the first band you were in was the high school band.
Yeah a band called Bumshit. It was a punk band. Didn't do, you know, did a little bit, made a record, but it was no big deal.
Okay, you know? What was the first band that you joined that started, you know, really taking it seriously?
I was in my first ska band. We took it pretty seriously. We lasted for about 2-3 years. It was called Scawberry Jam.
That's
it was
a cool
basically
name.
A ska cover band, you know how it is. We had 6 horn players. I played guitar and sang in that band. And you know, that was the first band where we were like, all right, let's try this. Let's see what we can do with it. And then from that, when that group broke up, I played with a couple other local bands for a little while. And then, last year, Max from Half Past Two, he noticed that I was playing trombone in my college and, he asked me to come and audition for Half Past Two.
Cool.
So, yeah.
And that's when you joined that band.
Yeah. So I joined Half Past Two and, started my other band, The Readjusters, about the same time, somewhere between December, February. 2018-2019.
Oh, right on. You said that they met you in school?
Is that what you said? No, he did I had the guitar player in Half Past Two, his name's Cameron Hallenbeck. He is a promoter in Orange County. He's a Pocket Entertainment, him and his fiance Whitney. And they had hosted Scawberry Jam at many a show. They gave us our first kind of break. So he knew of me, and I think the word spread to Max. They saw from social media that I was playing trombone with a couple of groups, and that's how I got into that.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
Pretty
okay.
Cool.
Yeah. So I saw that Half Past Two has like, they have like what, 5 records out or something?
Yeah.
When did you join? Like, when did you, were you able to
my
start
first,
recording?
We started, the first time I recorded with them was December of 2019. So every release we've had in this year I've been on. So Something Blue and Ska Funk Daily, which I helped write, which
Rad.
Is nice. Yeah.
Okay, so Something Blue is a new EP that just
yes, that is
out,
our,
right?
Our new EP. So that featured a song written by Cameron, the guitar player. That was See You Again. Lion Eyes was our old song. So that was the theme of Something Blue. It was, you know, something old, something new, something borrowed, something blue.
Oh, so, I love that.
Yeah, so that's so cool. I Will, See You Again, and Lion Eyes. Those were our three choices for that. And I arranged the horns for I Will, but obviously the Beatles wrote that one.
Right.
Yeah.
That's cool. Like,
yeah.
So do you arrange the horn parts now in the band?
Now I do. Yeah. Yeah. Most of the charts come to me first and then I'll go through it. And then, if I miss something or I mess it up, I always send it to the other horn players and they go through it and fix whatever they want. Or if there's a harmony they want to fix, that kind of stuff. But, for the new stuff we're working on, yeah, all the horn arranging, I typically do it and then I bring it to the band and we work on it together.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's interesting. So, okay. So you're writing the songs for the band, but you play guitar and sing. So it's not
crazy. Yeah. Right, so there's a song or two that I've wrote that we're working on for the next album, the next big thing for Half-Past 2. The only song that I have wrote right now in Half-Past 2 is Ska Punk Daily. I wrote that. And then Tara wrote the lyrics for that. So with that song, you know, I sat with my guitar and I wrote it all out in MIDI. I actually didn't even perform it. I wrote the entire score out first before anybody even played it. So that's how my brain works. I don't know. I like to write it out and see all the notes so I can visualize where everything is. Yeah.
Wow. Tell me about that. Okay. So you're very, very, very music oriented as far as you know, theory and the rote. If you can write notes,
that's my thing. Yeah. I like to look at the score and so I can figure out the chords. I can figure out why this should play this. I really liked Bach. Bach was my big thing. I like counterpoint and stuff like that. So I try to do that in my horn writing and do counterpunctal stuff and, you know, get pretty music nerdy with it.
Whoa. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
So how did you start learning to read music? Was that in,
that was in middle school.
Yeah. In the middle school band.
Yeah. In the middle school band.
And you just kept it up. Did you go to college or anything?
Actually in college right now. Yeah. So I study music technology, but my first 2 years I studied performance on guitar and I did trombone for a semester.
Okay. And
yeah.
So you're still going now?
And yes, I'm still going. Yeah.
Okay. Did you audition to get in? What school are you going to?
Fullerton Community.
Fullerton. Yeah.
Great jazz program. You know, I've made some really great friends there. But I went there for the audio program. The audio program was really nice. Very competitive. So I liked that program quite a bit.
But cool.
I've taken a lot of classical theory. I'm like classically trained in theory, that kind of stuff. So. I use that every day in my writing, you know.
I was going to say, that probably helps quite a bit.
Yeah, knowing what you're doing helps a lot. When you can actually think okay, well, if they're playing this and that, you know, so it helps a lot. And playing the horn as well, I have a nice advantage, I think, over some other songwriters because I play horn and I play guitar. So I know, what's good to do in rhythm section and I know what's bad to do in both. You know, I know what to avoid for horns, what to, you know, that kind of stuff. I know what I like to read, so I try to write that for other players too.
Wow.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I've never heard of it. I've never talked to somebody who wrote out the notes, everything first.
Yeah. Yeah. That's my method. It's a little wild. I'm kind of a madman, but you know,
you can hear everything in your head. You can just
for the most part,
I want it to go G D. Okay. Blah, blah, blah. And then
not like that crazy where I'm I'm not perfect pitch. I have good relative pitch, which is where I can hear a note and I can do the intervals, but I can't be oh, that's a C, that's a G, that's a, and I'm like, oh, I hear this melody of G8, whatever. No,
yeah.
It's more I can sense where I want the melody to go in my head and I'll spend the time to go through the notes and I'll play it on a piano or something, then I'll put it into MuseScore, which is the software I use. Yeah.
That's cool. That's really cool. Oh my gosh. Okay. Well, so I have so many questions now.
Yeah, awesome.
I personally don't know how to read music and I know a lot of musicians that are professional musicians.
Yeah, yeah, most don't. And it's not an important thing. But right, people, some of the best songwriters don't know anything about music theory. The Beatles, you know, they weren't music theory dudes. They were just good songwriters, you know?
Right, yeah.
They didn't know why, they just did. You know, they could just make these amazing songs. And when you analyze them, you're like, oh my God, this is genius. But to them, they're just like, oh, this sounds cool. You know, they're just tooting around on their piano.
I guess that's my question would be songs like that, if you break them down, are they just...
They're insane. The White Album by the Beatles. Some of the music on there, the things they're doing in their chord structure, you're like, what? This is insane because it's not like... Bach theory. It's not like typical pop songwriting. They're doing these things that are so unique to the Beatles and they've inspired everybody, you know.
Sure. Right. Okay.
So they're a great example of that.
Sorry, my dog's barking.
Oh, all good.
But yeah, wow. Okay. Well, in middle school and stuff, were you just really interested in the horn and learning that?
I liked guitar better always. I did trombone because my friends did it. So I did band because that's where my friends were. I loved band and I loved doing band, but I never practiced trombone. It wasn't the thing where I'm like, I'm going to go home and play trombone. It was I play trombone in the marching band. And, you know, I had enough of time playing in band and doing the things at school that I got pretty decent at trombone, but it was always guitar. I'd come home and play guitar. I took guitar lessons. I was constantly playing guitar.
Mm-hmm.
And I think... the love for that is what kind of pushed me to be better at trombone too, and try to be just a whole like a good musician. You know, that's the goal always.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah.
Well, like, were you into like ska and stuff, or were you like into punk? And were like, how do I incorporate my band instrument into this?
This is awesome. I was into punk. In middle school, I was really into like thrash metal and punk and just like really aggressive music, which is funny coming from like an orchestra kid, you know, who's playing like Bach and Mahler and all this stuff. but I just loved metal. And it's like, and then one of my friends, I also liked horn rock and funk. I grew up in a very musical household listening to all kinds of stuff. And I loved funk. I love Chicago, stuff like that. And one of my friends in high school who played trombone, he was my like section leader. He was, you know, a year above me. And he's like, hey, you should check out this band, A Real Big Fish. I think you might like it, you know. So they get you with that, and then he got me with Streetlight, and it was over. You know, I heard the horns, and I was like, what the hell? This is insane. You know, these guys are, like, just jamming. And I was, you know, I was playing punk already. I'm like, okay, well, how can we do this? You know, how can I get that? Because, like, that's the next thing for me.
Right, yeah.
Now I'm stuck. So.
Both, right?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. That's cool. So now you have – you're in three projects? You have –
So I play with Half Past Two. I play trombone. I also play with one of the oldest ska bands in the United States, the Untouchables. I'm very fortunate to play with some really fantastic musicians in that band. That was a really awesome opportunity that I got to pick up. And then I have my project, which is the Readjusters.
Readjusters. Well, tell me about your time with the Untouchables. Like, how did that really?
I got that gig because of I was playing at a Half Past Two gig, actually. Half Past Two was one of the support bands for the Scatolites at the Garden Amphitheater in Garden Grove, and the manager for the Untouchables just happened to be in the audience that night. She liked the way I was moving on stage and playing my trombone, and she Facebook stalked me and asked me if I'd be interested in being in the band. And I had my audition a couple weeks later. It was crazy. I had my first gig. I had like that band has never practiced before. So what the first practice in 20 years was with me, and we practiced before. It was insane. Yeah, it was the first time they had practiced. I mean, they weren't a practice band. They were just go to the gig and play. That's how they work. Because they were just picking up gigs, doing that thing. But I went to the first practice in 20 something years, and I got to meet the other horn players. And then I played my first gig with them was at this place called St. Rock up in Redondo Beach. Then the next week we played the Coach House sold out for New Year's Eve.
Oh my God.
It was pretty awesome experience. I've got to go on the road with them, went to Denver and Dallas, play a couple local shows, stuff like that. We had great plans for this year, but obviously because of the pandemic, things have been postponed and moved to next year, but it's going to be exciting stuff in the next year.
That's awesome. That's really cool. Wow. Did you know their songs prior to going?
No. I didn't know their songs at all, actually. Yeah, it was totally out of nowhere. I knew of them. They're one of those bands where, like, you recognize the name. I'm like, yeah, I've heard of the Untouchables, but it's not something where I was like, oh my God, the Untouchables. You know, it was like, okay, well, let's check this out. And then I looked into it. I was like, whoa, this is actually like a serious deal. This is a really cool step for my music career.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow. That's awesome. So you've done a few shows with them. You were supposed to do a tour, but obviously COVID.
Yes. Yeah, we were going to do a 17-day tour in November in England, but
oh my god,
obviously, yeah. So we're still waiting in details for when that's going to get postponed. But, yeah.
Have you played overseas before?
I have not. It was be my first European tour. Yeah, first time leaving the U.S. Yeah, I had my first two tours this year with Half Past Two and Untouchables. I'm only 21. I was 20 when I went on tour. So
oh my gosh, wow, that's awesome.
Yeah, a lot of firsts this year.
Yeah, well, tell me about that first tour.
It was fun. Let's see. I believe the first one was with the Untouchables. So it was just a quick weekend tour, 3 days. We went out to Denver and Dallas, played some great shows, at the Oriental and at Gas Monkey Garage.
It was a really cool experience.
No, we flew and we flew red eye. So we were in the airport at 3 a.m. So we'd get out of the gig at midnight, go to the hotel for an hour and then go get on the airplane at 3 a.m. Yeah.
Oh,
it was a rough
gosh.
Couple days. I didn't sleep much.
Yeah.
So kind of a crazy first experience, flying.
Right.
And then a few weeks later, Half Past Two did a week with the Toasters. And then my band, about a month later, the Readjusters, we did a week with a band from Texas called Madeline. So I've had a little bit of touring experience this year, which is really nice.
That's cool. Do you enjoy it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, it's so fun. Being out and like playing music with your friends and just getting to have a great time. I mean, you can't beat it.
Yeah.
It's an unbelievable feeling.
Was it a different experience going from like the Untouchables tour to doing the tours with
With Hefus and the Readjusters. Yeah, there's big learning experiences in all of them, you know, in like in dealing with, you know, in the Untouchables, I'm the youngest by 20 years. And then after that, it's another 15, 20 years, you know. So these guys who are in their 40s, 50s, 60s, I'm hanging out with them and I'm just stupid 20-year-old, you know, and we're flying and like getting these crazy cars, you know, we're getting these big old Tahoes and driving around Denver.
Well, I was going to say, yeah, did you get like, you probably have beautiful green rooms and stuff.
Yeah, the green, like, you know, food and all that. And then with Half Fest 2, you know, it was so much fun with Half Fest 2 because it's like we're all of us in a Ford Transit and we're just, you know, there was 11 of us in the van and we're just going to the, you know, we did the four days in a weekend. We played that weekend. I actually did double duty at one show, so I played with the Untouchables, and then I played with FS2 the same night up in Catch One in LA. So that was I played six shows in five days. Yeah, we were on the same bill because it was the Ska Fest. So yeah, I actually played with all three bands that week. So it was a pretty I had a lot of double duty that week. It was pretty nuts. I was pretty burned out when I got home, but it was I can't, you know, I wouldn't trade it for anything.
With the Untouchables, did you have to learn like their whole catalog?
I actually have a
set of songs.
They have a set of songs, but I transcribed all the horn lines, and so I sat and I wrote them all out, and I wrote them out for the other horn players too. So they gave me that gig. They're like, well, if you know we're getting new horn players, how would you like to write out the charts? You know, we'll help you out with that. And so they hooked me up, and I wrote out 20, 30 songs. You know, in 2 days, 3 days, it was insane. I did it right before that tour.
Oh my gosh, that's
crazy. It was insane. Yeah, it was stressful, but it worked.
Were you
out.
Able to bring that on? Like, if you couldn't remember this, did you have like sheet music?
I forgot my sheet music, so I used my cell phone.
But you could still use something.
Yeah. So I had a music stand, but this was looking at, you know, two pages of music, and I'd like scrolling on playing my trombone, and I'm like scrolling the music really fast trying to get it, you know. it was a little nuts, but it worked out. You do what you got to do.
Right. You definitely probably have an advantage knowing.
Yeah.
For those stuff. Like if you just went in there without, you'd have to try to memorize, you know, X amount.
That's a big set to memorize too, because they all, it's always a 90-minute set, and 90 minutes of like funk and soul and reggae music is intense, you know, especially with those charts, which they had really great horn players back in the day. And you're like, oh my God. And you're like trying to remember it, you know. Oh my gosh, even the guys, the two other players, they're fantastic. Gabe and Mel, great musicians, you know. Gabe played with No Doubt back in the day, you know. This just great horn players, and even they are like, holy crap, this is some hard shit. Yeah.
That's funny.
Yeah, man, it's awesome.
Well, tell me about your band, Rearrangers.
The Readjusters.
Readjusters.
Yes. The Readjusters, yes. So the Readjusters, that's, my project now. It's five horn players, you know, and then a five-piece rhythm or a four-piece rhythm section. So we're pretty thick bands.
Oh, my
too.
Gosh.
We're trying to do something new.
I didn't realize you're that big of a band.
Yeah, I'm in just big bands. I'm only in ridiculous-sized bands with lots of horns. I mean, it is all I do. So the Readjusters are, nine piece as well. It's just about the same size as Half Past 2. And in that band, you know, we started with the ska stuff, and that's how we got into it. Now we're kind of trying to transform our sound, do some, you know, new exciting stuff. So with that band, lately we've been working on our debut album, which is set to come out next year. I can't talk too much about it because we have, you know, kind of a whole thing with it. We want to try something that hasn't been done really, you know, try to do something that's unique and a little scary maybe.
Exciting. Awesome, cool. So you have new stuff coming out with that.
Yep.
And then obviously the new EP with
Half-Fest 2. Yeah.
Tell me about that EP. How was that experience working with those guys in the studio?
You know, it was fun. It was like I said, it was the first time we had recorded together. Mm-hmm. And it was a new way for them to record because typically, you know, with most groups, you'll set days and you'll have specific instruments going on those days and mm-hmm. they will track those instruments. We did all three of those songs in one day and all three of those videos in one day. So we started at, you know, 8 or 9 a.m. and we were there till 1 or 2 in the morning. And we did all of that in one day. And it was absolutely insane. But
so all the videos, everything like the
all those studio videos. So the videos of us
like
playing in the studio.
The video guys, you guys playing like the Beatles cover in the studio and stuff.
Yeah, so we did that for all three songs. We played all three songs, and we did that all in one day. Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
So it was a new experience for the band too, you know, but it was awesome. And, you know, it was really fun. The other horn players in that band, they're just awesome. You know, they're really good friends of mine now. And I'm very fortunate to get to play with horn players who are better than me in every band I'm in, you know, and they really pushed me to not be bad. So
yeah, that's good.
Yeah.
So with Half Past Two, did they come to you with like, does somebody write the song like on guitar and vocals and then say, and then you add to it as far as like the horns go?
Sometimes that's how it is. So some of the stuff we're working on for next year, we're working on, you know, a whole new set of songs and to release some more content in the next year. And with the new stuff we've been working on, yeah, it's a lot of that. It's a lot of, you know, Max or Tara or, you know, sometimes even other people will come up with some, like a basic idea. Maybe it's guitar and vocals. Maybe it's a little bit of a demo. There's maybe sometimes some horn parts. And then usually, you know, myself and then Din, the Barry sax player, we'll go through and we're like, okay, well, let's try this horn part and we'll try this thing or that. And then, you know, I've been at every writing session in the last couple months and we'll sit, we'll play through the songs, we'll try new things, we'll break down the sections, you know, and it's a different writing process because I'm so used to writing on my own. So it's been really nice to be able to work with other people and like, you know, kind of like cultivate ideas and see how we can make it better as a band, not just like, well, here's what I hear in my head, you know?
Right.
So it's a bit of a different experience, but I really enjoy it. It's a great way to write, you know, with other people. You come up with things that you wouldn't think of, you know, different inspirations are drawn and it makes the product better, I think. Yeah.
Were all those songs, you said you recorded all of them that one day with the videos, were they recorded live, like how you had the video shoot, or was that just after the fact?
We called it semi-live. You know, little studio magic. It was, you know, every section was together. So the horns all recorded together, the rhythm section all recorded together. And the only thing that was separate was Tara. But I think was actually in the vocal booth while they were, you know, doing their thing. So it was pretty much all at the same time. It was a little insane. Yeah.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
And I noticed that you guys have done a couple of the live streaming events.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah,
we have. How do you feel about those? Do you like them?
Oh, I really like them. I think it's really cool, and I think it's a great experience, especially for bands now, you know, with everything going on. It's a really great way that we can get our music to new audiences. You know, our music is spreading to people who may have never heard of a band from Orange County. You know, there's these people all along the East Coast and in other countries like in Japan and Russia and France and all these places that are hearing our music for the first time, and it's really exciting, all because of the internet, you know, the Supernova International Ska Festival, you know, that was all online, and the Ska Festival weren't today. I can't remember the name of it right off the top of my head, but those experiences have been a really great way for us to meet new people and, you know, grow in a way that we've never grown before. So I really like it. I think this is the way that a lot of media is going. I think the collaborations and working with people from around the world is really like what's starting to kind of take off.
Yeah. And how did you guys do it? Are you all like on your, like it, with the live sessions, or can you guys get together and play?
Tara does it. Tara and Max are like the kings. They, you know, they got like, they rule the castle, and they like, they're so good at scheduling and like telling us what we need to do. And like, they keep us all in check. You know what I mean? And without them, none of this would be happening. You know, they're emailing people all the time. They're responding to every message. They're going out and finding those things. And then, you know, I'll sit at home and I'll tune my trombone and send in a video, you know, and, or, you know, like the Brady Bunch cover we did. I was kind of like the product manager for that. So like I had to get everybody's recordings. I had to mix it. And then I had to, you know, make sure. And then I had to send all the videos and, you know, it worked out. It was a little stressful, a little last minute, but it, you know, I think the product turned out really nice.
That's cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
So do you have any, are you guys, you said you have a big project kind of in the works, but
yes,
that you're not going to talk about, but like with Half Past Two, are you, what's next for you guys? You just released the EP.
Right. Right now we're working on our next studio album. I think I can say that. Sorry, Max, if I can't. we're working on our next full length album, set to come out sometime next year. We want to do some, you know, Half Past Two's trying some exciting things. So expect more singles, you know, leading up to the album. We have some really, there's one very cool project that's going on with Half Past Two right now that I was a part of in the arranging aspect. And I cannot wait for people to hear it. I think it should be out in the next month or two. And it's
rad.
It is unbelievable. I'm very proud that I got to work on it.
Very cool. That's so awesome. And I saw that you teach music as well.
Yes, I do. I teach guitar and bass and ukulele. Yeah.
Oh, wow.
And yeah, it's a great experience.
How many instruments can you play?
Six. I can play six, but I say I play three well.
Okay.
So I play guitar, bass, and trombone well. And then the other ones, I just kind of, you know, I can play enough. I can play enough piano. I can play uke and I can play mandolin.
Okay. You know, that's awesome.
Attempt other things. Yeah. Yeah, it's good.
Do you like teaching? Does that help you?
I love it. And I love inciting my love for music and other people. I love seeing, you know, because I have students of all ages. I have students who are 9 years old, 77 years old. You know, I've got this big range of students, and seeing what makes them happy with music really helps me too. You know, getting to see my, you know, my 77 year old student, you know, he's rocking out playing the blues. He's really, you know, working hard for it. You know, right. I've got mid 50s who are just like trying to be in, you know, cover bands and just hang out and just be good enough, you know? And then I got kids who are, you know, where I was at, you know, 10 years ago at the same shop learning lessons, you know?
Right. Right.
And, you know, seeing their musical journeys, you know, it's really inspiring. And I love that part of it for sure.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
Dude, thank you so much for hanging with me today. I really appreciate it.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks for having me. This was a blast.
Yeah. So I have one more question. I want to know if you have any advice for aspiring artists.
Ooh, be different. Try new things. Don't be scared to fail. You know, sometimes sticking in the status quo and trying to do the safe thing isn't the best option. You're going to, you know, take big risks, try new things, and especially now, because there's so much music out there. There's so many great bands, so many great people, you know, strive to be different, strive to be something that catches people's eye. You're like, well, you know, what are they doing over there? That seems, you know, it's new. So that's what I would say. Just try to be different.